There are quite a few people here, you know. This is a big deal. This is TED, and it's very exciting. And so I'm glad that I'm talking about this particular subject because in some ways, I actually function as my own visual aid here. Right? So, take that, PowerPoint. This guy is my nemesis, currently. I've been working on this PowerPoint and this sort of talk for quite a while now, and I've been really concerned about how I was going to present anxiety to you guys so that you could get a sense of what that's like living day to day. And I figured the best way to sort of demonstrate that for you was to show you my negotiation with PowerPoint. So these are the slides that I didn't end up using. There are about 20 of them. Okay, so I promise all of these slides had relevance at one time. Am I going too fast? On the bottom? Okay, only the bottom? Alright, so at one point all of these had relevance to the talk that I'm giving today. They were all connected, and yes, there was a glitter beard in there, and yes, that is Donald Trump. So, I got to this place where I was dealing with it every day. I was trying to figure out the best way to communicate, keep this sort of anxiety that I experience on a daily basis. And I guess the question for me is, are you guys as nervous as I am? Probably not right now. I mean, you guys have like comfortable chairs, it's Friday night, and I'm up here rambling and trying to remember what I was supposed to say to you. So our levels of anxiety are different at this point in time, but I think maybe in the back of your mind there's something maybe nagging. Maybe you're worried about your bills, or maybe you're worried about your AP tests. So we have this kind of pervasive sense of worry, and for me, what's really interesting about this is that I didn't always used to be this way. I was not a naturally nervous person. When I was growing up, I was adventurous. I hiked, I rappelled, I went the distance, I was bold and brave. I loved social interaction, I was all up in there, and at some point, I stopped doing it. And I kind of, you know, went into myself, and I was nervous about everything I said, every interaction that I participated in. It just changed. And so, I've been trying to figure out what it was that changed for me, that made me feel so differently about my life and about my interactions with other people. So the first thing that like occurred to me was that I think that I can pinpoint the time that I became a nervous person to around my high school graduation. Around then, somewhere in that space, between high school and the first year of college, I became a nervous person. And so I thought about this a lot, and I thought about what changed. And the sort of prevailing thing is that at that point in my life, I got involved in academics. I also became really attuned to university culture. It was a really exciting time for me. The problem with, of course, academia, if any of you are familiar with it, it's one of those places that you go to learn about what you know. And the problem with that is that when you start looking at what you actually know, you realize you don't know anything at all. And so for a person with nervous anxiety, it's recognizing that you don't actually have a clue about what you're doing is probably not the career choice for you. And it probably was the worst thing I could have done for myself, but I did it. And so that's what we have here now. The other thing is that I became a teacher. These are some examples of student work that I collected from various colleagues and stuff. And these sentences appeared in papers that were supposed to be peer-reviewed, final edits, really. As a teacher, this makes me anxious, right? Am I effectively communicating with my students? Am I talking with them? Are they actually learning? Anybody at all? procrastination, you know, people waiting to the last minute. But at the same time, this is something that we sort of consistently get anxious about and consistently complain about. You know, the other thing is that I work with a group of people who are, we talk all the time, we work in a bullpen, and we talk all the time kind of about our jobs, and I happen to be an adjunct instructor. And what that means is that I teach classes, but I'm on a contract for semester to semester, so sometimes you know, classes don't fill, or they decide not to renew our contract, and that can be a very intimidating place to work, and can be really frustrating. So we've shared our anxieties about that, we've shared our anxieties about this, right? All together talking, right? This is huge. This happened just this week, and we talked about it in the office. We're also deeply concerned about this. As English professors, I think that's, you know, or instructors, that's our right and privilege. So we've had these anxieties, and I thought maybe that's where it is. Maybe it's rooted in my concern about being a professional and being an academic. Maybe I'm just worried about what I don't know. But the truth is that most people worry about their jobs. 68% of Americans would say that they are worried about their jobs. And so this is not something new. It's not just my profession. It's not just academics that worry. It's not just academics that question what they know and what they don't. This is sort of a universal experience. So maybe it's not about that, you know? I thought, you know, possibly, maybe, what if it has to do with the fact that I'm a woman, and that I've been taught to do this my whole life, right? This is supposed to be the epitome of femininity, right? A woman throwing herself, nerves and all, down onto a couch, and that's an expression of femininity that we recognize, that we appreciate, that we encourage in a lot of ways. So maybe it's rooted in that. But then I realized that that's not really fair to men, and they worry too. For example, these are some from a hashtag that appeared last year on the internet called fragile masculinity. And you'll notice in some of the photos, that one over there on the left has soap that is man-sized, right? Because men cannot use apparently small soap that would hurt their manliness and their feelings. And so they have to use big soap, right? So they're clearly worried. If we're changing our soap, we're clearly worried about our masculinity, all right? So I thought that maybe that had something to do with it. At least it's fair and balanced, right? So women are nervous. And the only difference, really, is that women are allowed to express their anxiety. They're allowed to talk about it, right? And in fact, it's an encouraged behavior for them, because when they do that, they prove that they're good women. In fact, women who are more anxious are more likely to be married longer and have more children. Women are also twice as likely to be diagnosed with anxiety. So we are obviously more vocal about it, but that doesn't mean that men aren't experiencing it. And so it's not my job, and it doesn't seem to be my gender. So maybe it's some combination of both of those. In 1978, a pair of researchers noticed a pattern in professional women, where women would not be able to recognize their achievements. They wouldn't be able to talk about the things that they had accomplished because they would be consistently attributing all of their success to luck, right, or circumstance. Basically, they felt worthless, and they felt like they couldn't accomplish any of the goals that they had. What ends up happening is that these women who feel worthless feel like somebody's going to figure it out. At some point, somebody's going to come along and be like, you don't fit in, you don't work, right? And so that's the anxiety that I feel every day in my interactions with people, and especially standing in front of all of you guys here. So what if this is it? Does this make sense? The problem with this idea is that it's not just me as a professional woman. Every single person, at some point or another, has this experience. Ladies and felt this way about their lives at some point or another, that they were an imposter and that somebody was going to find them out. So it's not about any of those things. It turns out everybody is just anxious all the time. And what's interesting about that is that we have turned our adulthood into something that makes us anxious. It's now really hard to be an adult, right? We've turned adulting into a verb so that we can kind of handle the day-to-day things that happen to us that make us feel anxious and nervous. And the problem with this is that it seems like to me that what has happened in our society is that we've basically given up on how we're going to deal with anxiety. We have decided that there's not really a solution, and so we should just embrace it, right? We should just become the anxious people that we actually are. And so we frame anxiousness as a way to be more intelligent, as a universal experience. We look at it as though it's good for you, as though it's helpful to you, right? And what ends up happening is we get a whole slew of disorders. So 40 million Americans suffer from a diagnosable anxiety disorder. That's 20% of the population, right? And so there's a huge number of people, 1 in 5. And instead of sort of curbing that tendency, we're encouraging it. We have changed this into a new value that we want to instill in our families and in our children. And I think it's really problematic. I especially have been thinking this while I've been talking about, or I've been thinking about parenting. You know, in the olden days, right, our older 1950s, 60s, when we had these sitcoms, we had this ideal of a family. You know, June Cleaver vacuuming with her pearls, meatloaf on the table at 5, right? Dad home right on time. And then the problems were really solvable then, right? At least within 25 minutes, every real problem that came up could be solved on each episode. And this was a really problematic way to look at home life and at family life. It was really destructive because people were trying to meet a standard that they couldn't, right? And in response to this sort of idea, I think that we've pushed, you know, as a way to kind of push ourselves away from this, we've gone to the other extreme. And in fact, this now is what we consider the ideal family situation, okay? Because the people in this photo are good parents. They're anxiously engaged in their relationship. They're concerned about their child, right? We are bringing anxiety into parenting as a way of showing our willingness for self-sacrifice. And we're holding it up as a value. So, and I think this is applicable everywhere. You know, if my to-do list is longer than yours, then I must be doing something really important. If I have a harder college application process, if it's more grueling than you, if I lose sleep over it, if I am visibly shaking, I must be taking this whole life experience way more seriously than you do. And so for me, we've turned anxiety into a value that we want to pass on. And I think we start seeing this earlier and earlier. I think, you know, 1 in 6 college students will be diagnosed with depression. And we see this in our high school students too, as they go through exams and have those experiences. And so I think we have to do something about this. I think we have to stop this from happening. And as I was sort of preparing for this talk, and I was thinking about this, the first question to me was, why would I agree to do this? This is the perfect storm of all the things I hate about myself, about experience. I don't think that I can handle being in front of this many people. The possibility of the internet is just terribly frightening, right? And the truth is that I think this is important enough that we have to do something about it now. Because if we don't, what's going to end up happening is that we're going to raise a generation of people, and next generations, and we're going to be combating stereotypes about how we should be anxious in our lives, in our circumstances. And so I felt like, even though this was very difficult, that I wanted to make sure that that was clear. And so, yeah, that's it. Thank you.